We have roughly 2.6 million subscribers, television subscribers, and we cover New York, New Jersey, and Connecticut. You'll probably notice we are probably the most serious company in the MSO community when it comes to data and all things related to data. Over the last 24 months, every single decision within the company, and I mean every single decision from operations efficiency, truck rolls, programming negotiations, advertising, everything goes through a rigorous data analytics process, and we make the decision based on accurate set-top box data. Over the next 15 minutes, I'm gonna take you through our six-year journey. I'm gonna try to do it in 15 minutes in this world of data. Very complicated, very complex, yet fascinating. If you have questions, I'll be surprised that I'll have enough time at the end, but my associates are here. We can take the questions. The objectives when we launched the six-year journey, we had really two. One is we wanted to find lost audiences. We wanted to find the lost audiences for ourselves, for our clients, for our partners. The second objective was to help our struggling ad business at that time and use data-driven analytics so we can and data-driven campaigns to help compete against the digital advertising that was eating part of our business. So we've accomplished very successfully both objectives, yet we stumbled and we experienced a collateral benefit by building a standalone business today, which is a data business, which we founded and, I run, and it's one of the fastest growing businesses we have in the company. But with these objectives in mind, let me start with the first lesson we learned. When you say lost audiences, everybody talks about lost. In reality, when you run a lot of analytics on the lost audiences, you find that there are three definitions. First, lost audiences are the ones that have always been there, but you've never known about them. Why? Because the measurement systems are outdated and they never caught them. Second, lost are the ones who were there for you, whether you're a programmer, an advertiser, or an MSO, but they left. They're still there. You can still get them back, but you need to be very meticulous on how you bring them back. The third lost are the ones you had and you lost them forever, either to a competing platform or a competing program. Each and every one of the lost definitions changed the way our clients made decisions when they found about them. When you know that there were 8% more ratings or more audiences on your networks that you've never in your life knew they existed, your decisions from a programming, marketing, ad sales, and distributions suddenly change completely. And when you know that I lost audiences maybe 10% in the last year, but I know how to bring them back, your decisions change. So the way to tackle lost audiences requires three A's. You can't do it with two. You really need three A's. And today's measurement systems, believe it or not, are not gonna be able to help you. They're not made for these kind of audiences. They're made for ratings, and I'll go through that. First A is you need to be accurate. When you wanna find lost audiences, you better be accurate finding the right lost audiences. Two, you need to address them. You need to go after them and bring them back. Three, you need an accountable measurement systems to tell you exactly did you bring them back or you did not. Not a hypothetical, not a model, not a projected way. So let's start with first step we had to take. So we collected 1% of our set-top box data and we collected 10% of our set-top box data thinking, hey, we can probably tackle the lost audiences. But what we found is there's a multi-million dollar question every company is gonna have to face if they wanna pursue this. Is it census, big data, or is it sample and a panel? What do you do? So we had to take a step back and study it in a substantial way. What we concluded finally is that panel and sample is ideal if your business or your partners or your clients are working with you for mass marketing strategies or to generate mindshare. And how do you measure that? You measure it by ratings and you measure it by reach. The higher the rating points, the higher the reach, the more successful you are or they are. It answers questions like, and in fact, it answers the only question of what happened. What was the rating at a point in time? Yesterday, last week, last month. What was the reach? What was the frequency? It stops. It's a point in time. It usually does it for age, gender, maybe location, maybe race, but it doesn't do it much more than that. Why? The sample is small. And it's very good for top networks and prime time. However, if you are using census or big data, your clients or yourself may be after gaining market share. Maybe you're going after relevant households. I want to reach households who watched 6 episodes last season. This is not a ratings game. This is 6 episodes live last season, or 5 episodes in a DVR mode, or ordered 16 VOD assets last month. This is relevant household shares. Also, for targeting and addressability, you can't do that with a ratings model. You need census level or big data. Forensic analytics, the terms we use internally. There's always, when something goes wrong in the media, there's always one of the 4 culprits. It's either programming, or either marketing, either the research department, or the measurement systems. We're not doing forensic analytics to slap these folks. We're doing it to help them fill the gaps when they're doing their jobs. And you're gonna see examples of how we do that. Predictive modeling, you can't predict using a sample. You need big data, you need historic data. Conversion measurement, households that were exposed to an ad that they end up tuning in and watching the program, or that they end up buying the card. Finally, multi-screen analytics. How do you measure that? You measure by capturing every single impression, either through the set-top box or smart TVs, which is ACRs, IP data to do multi-screen analysis, as well as transaction data, and we're gonna take you through some examples. They answer questions of why something happened. If your rating points went down last week, big data can answer why exactly they went down. Did your audiences leave you and they watched you in DVR, or did they go ordered on demand, or did they just go to a different screen? These are the questions. Why something happened, to whom it happened. Believe it or not, viewers on televisions are not the same. Even of the same program, they're not the same. You have multiple dimensions. Heavy viewers, light viewers, the same genre, they just like that show. You can all flush it out with big data. How often is something happening? And most importantly, that's what we thrive on. Will something happen? We can predict to our clients today that if they spend $1 million, for example, on a campaign on a year, and they run it between this week and that week, and this month and that month, we can predict within 5% accuracy the reach, the viewership by segment, and the frequency. That you can master after you have 2 years of data. So with that in mind, we as a company, we said we're not interested in the first layer. That is well taken care of by the measurement systems today, the Nielsen's, the Comscore's. They do a great job there. We're interested in the second one for our own business. So we asked ourselves to redefine the television. What if we start collecting every single second of every single episode, of every single program, of every single network, of every single viewing mode, live, DVR, and VOD, of every single household? And what if we made that data available within 24 hours to our folks and our stakeholders, and we can build a track record of 36 months? Imagine what we could do. So the journey started. Today, we collect 2.6 million set-top box worth of data in an aggregated, de-identified manner, privacy compliant, and that represents roughly 7.3 million set-top boxes. But don't take our word for it. We hired KPMG, because it's hard to go out to the market and say, hey, it's our data. We hired KPMG, and they did an exhaustive 1-year audit on the data. And we received the SOC 3 compliance that attests that our data is of quality, available, reliable, and can be used for purposes of analytics. So what did we do with that? First, we wanted to help our advertising business. So we built a data-driven advertising portfolio. And the byproduct of that, or the collateral benefit, we call it, is a standalone data business. Let me take you through the first one. Data-driven advertising today, 30% of all our ad revenues today come from this mode. The way we do it is, first, accuracy. In other words, we create accurate segments for our audience. You tell us what is that segment you want to reach. Is it households that are heavy viewers of live television of your program, or live television of genre like your program, or households in the market for an SUV, or households who are frequent travelers international? You define the segment, we will create it for you. Accurately. We don't project it, accurately. Second, we use the set-top box data in order to build the media plans based on each segment, not in general, per segment. We run the campaign in an addressable format to that household, and then we measure accurately every single impression by segment, and I'll show you an example. How do we create the segments? One of the 3 ways. Our clients can come to us, they have their own CRM data, we do a double-blind match through Experian or Acxiom or third-party companies, and we create those segments. Second way is we can go to Experian or Acxiom and build segments based on their data and their models. Third, we use our set-top box data to create segments. We create segments today for our clients, households that watched their last season, but they're not watching them anymore. We can create those households, give them accurate counts, and then we move to the next step. Next step is we use the set-top box data relevant to those households, and we analyze the best networks, best programs, best day parts that they watch, and we build the plan. Then we run a campaign to these households specifically with the creative of the client. And we use Visible World, and I saw Garrett here earlier. We use Visible World to reach those audiences with the creative. But we took it a step further. We said, why only reach these households? Why not even tailor the creative to each household? If the household is a frequent traveler, they get the creative that is relevant to that. And if it's a working mom, she gets the creative relevant to that. And after the campaign runs, we don't just do posting. We deliver impression delivery by segment. We do it by day part. We do it by segment, by network. We do it by hour, impressions by live versus DVR. And we do it by reach and frequency by segment. But why stop here? When you have that big data, you take it a step further and you do now conversion analysis and ROI. So households, for programming purposes, who were exposed to the campaign and saw the ad, did they end up watching the program? And how did they watch it, live, DVR, or VOD? On the brand side, I blacked out the name of the cars, but we do it by model. Households, for example, if you're an automotive client, you ran a campaign for different creatives, different segments. Households that were exposed to that model, the SUV, for example, did they end up within 3 months buying that SUV? If not, did they buy a competing product? And what happens suddenly is your marketing department start building business cases. How much should we spend? What was the cost of acquiring a car? And should we continue doing that? And are we doing it in the right time? So we start running these models. Suddenly, we're partners. We're not just ad sales. We're partners with the client. A byproduct is clients started coming to us and asking us, by the way, I'm not interested in buying advertising to get the benefit of all that data. Can you run analytics for me to help me run my business? Fill in the gaps that the measurement systems are not doing today. So we build this business that has different products, and I'm not going to dwell on it, but in general, we have 6 products, and it continues to grow. So here's an example of a programmer who came to us and said, do I have lost audiences, or do I have not so lost audiences? Can you help me? And if you can, find them for me. Tell me something about them. So we said, what type of audiences are the ones you're going after? Their answer was, I want households that watched 5+ episodes last season, but they watched it in DVR. And I want to know, can I monetize them? What do they look like? So we told them the demographics that they asked. They wanted to sell them based on income, age, and education. Here is those households that you think you lost. This is their demographics. By the way, here's how they're spread geographically, right? So they can go and do local ad sales based on the location of these audiences. And again, there's no disclosure of addresses or anything. It's zip code level here. But then, by the way, if you want to catch them and bring them back, here's the best networks and programs that they watch. We gave the details of the program level that they can advertise on to bring them back. Remember, these households are not watching them live anymore, so they don't show up in the ratings. And they were over 8%, by the way, of their ratings. What's their source of destination? Here's where they are 5 minutes before they come to watch your show, and here's where they go to the right 5 minutes after they watch your show. It's important to know if they turn on the set-top box and they watch you, or they were watching sports and came in. And it's important to know that they turn off the set-top box after they're done watching you. If yes, you have a hard time reaching them if you want to advertise, so we advise an online campaign. But if they're watching different programs, advertise on these programs to go watch you in a DVR mode or on demand. Finally, they said, I ran 5 campaigns last season, 5 different creatives. Which creative got these households to convert and watch me the most? It was creative number 5, which, by the way, cost them less than $2,000. Creative number 1, that was the least efficient, cost them $1 million. Just think of that. What kind of a marketing decisions would you do when you have this kind of information? Now, here's an interesting one. Client comes to us and says, I'm running a brand new program, brand new series. I have no data to fall back on from last season. It's a screwed up kind of a genre. Teens, blood, fiction, not going to disclose it. They said, I can't just go to a traditional models of ratings and figure out how do I project. I bought my campaign, tune-in campaign, and I ran it. Can you just keep your eyes on it to find out if I'm losing audiences? So they ran the first episode, 80,000 households. Ran the second episode, 78,000 households watched it. In your opinion, is this good or bad? It's fascinating. So they looked at it from a ratings point, applause, great, we did a great job. What's our opinion? It was like, absolutely not, this is a disaster. Why? We said only 28% of those who watched the first episode came back and watched the second episode. Ratings, phenomenal. High fives. Reality, a disaster. So, their second question to us was, I didn't hear it, and I don't know if I should hear the comment, but anyway, so we said, we're raising the red flag. We can't tell you if you lost them categorically or if this was an odd event. They said, tell us more about them, what happened. So we go and get minute by minute for the first episode. The dark blue is the first episode. Every single minute during the 2 hours of the show. If you see the sinusoidal peaks from an analytics perspective, this is a health. It's like a heartbeat. People go out during the advertising, they come back in, but it's at the same level. This is very good. Second episode, two peaks, and the third one, it never came back. We said, those are the audiences you lost. We sliced them out, and we looked, and they went to a premiere of a different show on a different network, premiere of a new season. Actually, it was a new series. And we tracked them for a couple of weeks after that. They never came back. Those are lost audiences. So you think there's nothing to be done? No. From a programming perspective, you can move an hour front, back, or front, or you can change the day, and you can capture those audiences back. From a marketing perspective, you can slice those audiences out and go target them with a campaign to say, come back, watch me on DVR, because you know they liked your show. Look at the first wave. They stayed on the show the first episode. So they left because the other show was better. That doesn't mean you lost them. This is what we're talking about, that big data can help you. And today, the client uses this kind of service for every program they run on our network. The last one, a sports network came to us and said, well, how can you use the big data to help me? We said, well, how do you define your audiences today? They're not one audience. In their mind, they have five different views of clients. They have what they call the super casual, all the way to the super avid. I'm going to invite you for time's sake to look on the right and on the left for this analysis. They define that it's 1 game to 2 games deems a super casual viewer. 26 to 38 games is what they call the super avid. Everything in between, they gave it different definitions. So they said, what do they constitute? When you're using ratings, it's the law of the average. You get one number for all of them. You don't know the light, the heavy, or in the middle. You have no idea. So what we analyzed for them is 76% of their viewers during that season were super casual and only 1% were super avid. But watch this. So they said, how many games on average each one watched? So we said your super casual, who represents 76% of your audience, watches on average 1 game per season. The super avid, they represent 1%, but they watch roughly 32 games. Wow, great insights. Let's take it a step further. So how much time they spend when they watch that game? Super casual, 76% of your audience, they watch on average 1 game, but when they watch that 1 game, they spend 30 some minutes. Super avid, 1%, they watch 32 games, on average 2 hours and 10 minutes per game. Now you see the reality starting to show up. All right, one more step. Well, what percentage of the consumption of viewership they represent? The 76% consume 19% of all minutes watched on their networks. The 1% consume 19 minutes watched. Well, you're gonna say, Paul, what does that mean to me? If you're a marketing or an ad sales person, first of all, no, let's say you're a marketing, you're advertising your sports networks to your audiences. What would you do with this data? Do you spend your money advertising on for the super avid? They're gonna come in regardless. Or do you do it for the super casual? Or do you spend the money saying, let me focus on the casual fan and the avid? Paul, what are the networks and day parts or programs that I need to watch to get to reach these folks? And then measure that they watch. If you're an ad salesperson in that network, and you've been selling BMW as this is the brand for to reach these audiences, and then you find out that the super avid, right, are low-income households, would you still sell BMW? Or would you go to, let's say, a different brand that may be more conducive to them? What if the super casual end up being the singles, single male, and the super avid are family? I'm exaggerating here. But your ad strategy changes, your sales changes, your CPM changes, because now you can target. You can tell them, here's the audiences who are watching the most. One is reach, one is targeting. You make the decision. In conclusion, final thoughts. to get lost audiences, if you're serious about it, and we've seen instances where there's roughly 20% of the ratings that are not measured or lost and can be recaptured. If you're serious, keep in mind, data, once you start getting involved with it, is your second most valuable asset after your employees, because it's yours and yours only. It's a private kind of asset that, well used, can help you generate revenue, cut costs, create efficiencies, and enhance your customer experience. Second, a successful data strategy requires a collaborative approach. This is not an IT group. This is not one division, and a collaborative approach internally between organizations and externally with your partners, with your agencies, programmers, advertisers, MSOs. You should work together on your collaboratively on your strategy. Last but not least, it's about the art, the science, and the business. A lot of people confuse it. They say, I have a great IT department that does data. Means nothing, I guarantee you. I have a great business department that does data. Nothing. Science, I have a great data science team. They have to be in sync. Because what IT does doesn't mean that the data science can do something with it. It's, think about it as a kitchen. You have the chef, the ingredients, and you have the appliances. They all have to work together. And if you can't do it, trust me, it's a very expensive value proposition, and you're gonna not see the results you aspire. Thank you very much. Sorry I took probably more time.